Remain standing. We're going to go ahead and recite the words of the Apostles' Creed found on the back of your bulletin. If you believe these words, repeat after me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is sitting on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, Heavenly Father, thank you, thank you, thank you that we can come to you today, that we can gather with our brothers and sisters in Christ to worship you freely, God. Father God, we went through a trial this week, Lord, many of us in different ways, Lord, and we see, Lord, all the things, so many things that we take for granted on a day-to-day basis, running water, electricity, warmth. Lord God, we know that this storm, Lord, was just a product of sin in our world, God, your judgment on this world, God, but yet you are good and you are faithful, Father. We thank you for your provision through the entire situation, Lord, and that we are standing here today, Lord, still praising you, still worshiping you, Father God. Lord, be with any of those who are in need, Lord, whether they need water, electricity. Father God, you know the needs, Lord. We ask that you meet them and help us as a church, Lord, to be your hands and your feet, Lord, to be able to serve you, to help those who are in need, for your glory and your name to be proclaimed. All these things I ask in Jesus' most holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Announcements this morning. We have the ladies' retreat still scheduled for February 26th or 28th listed in the bulletin. Valerie, is that still, or yes? Okay. Okay.
So if you have any questions or anything, I send out an email, you can talk to me afterwards.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I know that's going to be a good time. I'm excited. My wife gets to go. Any ladies here, I encourage you to go. Pray for me, though. It'll be my first time watching all three kids overnight by myself. First time Obadiah's been without his mama overnight. Pray for me. Pray for me. It'll be good. Pray for the women's retreat. Pray for the women's retreat, that God would speak to our women, fill them up. We are so thankful for all that they do for the Lord. They are gifted. We thank God for them. Is there, well, one other announcement I do have. This Thursday, 7 p.m., we will be having our monthly men's meeting here at the church. We also have a board meeting, to my understanding, at 6 p.m. So just a reminder for those of you on the board, 6 p.m. this Thursday. Any men who would like to come to the men's meeting, 7 p.m. here at the church. We're facilitating a discussion on biblical manhood, attributes of a godly man. What is that in the Bible? Please do not misunderstand. This meeting is not John David trying to teach men how to be men. I'm just a facilitator for discussion and hoping to learn how to become a godly man and understand, because in our world, in our society today, gender roles that God designed for his specific purpose to communicate truth about him is being eradicated. And it's important that the church, who knows the truth, seek to understand these things and live them to be the light of the world for us. So 7 p.m. men's meeting. Do we have any other announcements? I do want to take a brief time for testimonies. For anyone who wants to praise God for things they witnessed and saw this week and how God met needs whenever needs were needed. But is there any other announcements? Georgie, yes, ma'am.
Yes. If anybody has any questions about the confusing email I sent, here I am. Number two, if you know anybody that is struggling with food, whatever, especially during this time, people not being able to go to work, whatever, please email me. I have some gift cards. And also, yesterday, I stood in line at Walmart, and I managed to get 2 cases of water.
Oh, praise God.
I am willing, if anybody needs a case for drinking water, just see me after, and it's in the back of my van.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Anyone who is in need from this week, see Georgie, but also see us as a church. We want to know those needs. We want to be able to help meet them. You know, my house is still without running water. Tomorrow will have been 7 days, no running water in our house. I brought my kitchen sink with me to do dishes after the service because thank God we got running water here in the church. So if there are any needs, please let us know. Water, anything. We want to make sure that we can be able to support our church. Yes, Azine.
So I just wanted to give a share testimony. We were just sitting at home, and 2 separate neighbors came and rang our doorbell and gave us packs of water. Oh. And so God is so good, and He provides it. It was funny because I was just sitting on Amazon, like, you know, I'm not brave enough to venture out with these 3 kids, this world myself, try to get anything. So I'm going to try to see if I can order my water online. I just ordered a 12-pack for $20. Then he shows up, so I was able to cancel that order and get our money back because God is so good. And then when we did have electricity, we were playing, you know, a matching game, and Naomi was so sweet. She turns over a card, and then she's like, "Wait, let me pray." And she just prayed, "God, help me to find the match."
and then she was right.
And then she was
yes. Thank you, Azine. Does anyone else have any testimonies? Jerry, yes, sir.
I got plenty of water where I live, and I've told, so I had already a church member or two come out there, and I got well water, but you can tank up all you want. So if you are sure, please be able to come over there where I live, get all the water you want. I've had water all along.
Thank you, Jerry. Yes, sir. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Well, the pastor said that we could get back to somewhat normal. Although it's taken a lot of training for the ushers to learn how to back out. And so today, we're going to do it whenever it's time. I thought I would look to go.
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely.
Because I keep looking, God, what's the good that's going to come out of all this? Mm-hmm. And one of the things is we reconnected as a neighborhood. And we're helping one another. So praise the Lord. I mean, that's just awesome. Blessing for these guys.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? I do want to thank God that, you know, as the power was out for us for over 24 hours at one point in the night, it got really cold. And, you know, I was very worried about Obadiah, you know, being a little baby. It was up every hour checking on him. He got comforts on. But thank God that we had some friends reach out to us. Our cell service wasn't working either. But we had some friends with power and water reach out, willing to take us in. You know, some Christians some believers who just want to be the body of Christ. And I encourage you all to continue to look to the Lord to see how he can use you in this time. Now we're going to move forward to our time of prayer requests. If you have something you would like the church to be praying for you with at this time, please stand. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you so much for these testimonies, God. People who are giving you glory and seeing the work that you are doing in and through neighbors, in and through people, in and through your instruments, Lord, to be good, Lord, to be beneficial, to be loving, to be kind, to give, Father, to those who are without in need. We praise you for that, Father. Lord, be with those who are standing right now. You know all the needs that are going on inside of their life, Father God. We ask that you meet those needs, Lord, whether it's healing, whether it's financial needs, spiritual needs. You know, Father, you are all-knowing God, and we know we can come to you and ask you for your provision. Please meet these needs, Father God. We thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's go ahead and stand for hymn number 354. To come forward to be able to pass the collection plates. Thank God that we are able to fear not and move forward with what the Lord would have us to do. Chris, would you mind giving the prayer this morning?
Lord, thank you for allowing us to meet in the house today in your worship. Please let us continue to be mindful of you and listen to you. Open our hearts and open our minds that we will hear the words that need to be heard today. And be with David as he gives the sermon today. Please be with us the rest of the week, and thank you for us getting us through this last environment. Please be with this country and our leaders. Please allow them not to be too foolish, and allow them to make right decisions, and may our country continue to be in glory to you. Please bless these offerings today that we may use them in your need and for your glory. In your son's name, Jesus, we pray.
Amen. Thank you, Chris. Sure, let's finish this and we'll be able to share. Okay. Would you like to share your testimony?
Sorry.
There's one more testimony that someone would like to share briefly, and then we will have the doxology. I apologize, Jean. Yes, ma'am.
Not just this way, but for a year and a half. God has provided me a home with the Lord. Mm-hmm. He's given me a home all the cold, the very front of it, the melt through it all cold. Mm-hmm. I'm starting because I didn't think this was the right kind of difference. But it is. I'm more thankful for the year and a half almost that I've lived with her. I've been safe. I've had food. I've had water. I've had whatever I needed. I've had transportation to and from wherever I needed or where I needed to go. And I just thank the Lord that He's been so faithful to help me through this.
Amen. Amen. And thank you, Beth. And we thank God for Christ living in Lorna, being the witness that she is for our Lord. Thank you, Lorna. Let's go ahead and rise for the doxology. Special music this morning.
Thank you, sir. Look, God's in control. It don't matter what happens. Always remember, He's got it. He's in control of it. So whatever goes, that's what He handles. Listen. Okay, Jim. Praise His Lord. Take my hand. Lead me on, let me stand. I am hard, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows dear, gracious Lord, lead me near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand. I fall, take my hand, gracious Lord, lead me home. Gracious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am weary, I am weak, I am worn. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Amen, and He leads us all home, don't He?
If you brought your Bibles, let's go ahead and open up to the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter 3. We're going to be covering verses 1 through 6 this morning. Exodus 3, verses 1 through 6. This morning's sermon is titled, Man on Fire. Exodus 3, 1 through 6. I love seeing Bibles open. It's important that we read the Word of God for ourselves if we are able to read. Exodus 3, beginning at verse 1. Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. Then he said, do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer one more time. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for everything that was mentioned in this service. All glory to you. Right now, Lord, we know that it is your will for us to stand, Lord, and preach your word, regardless of the instrument, Father, to be able to see you and glorify you. Lord, we ask that you be in this service, Lord, that your Holy Spirit move in a mighty way to speak to all of us, Lord, removing John David and just having you put on display, God, your name, your purpose, your plan, everything that you want us to come to understand as we trust you by faith on this side of eternity. Lord, in the power of your Spirit, move in a mighty way, God. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. This morning we're going to be examining the biblical account in which God first appears to Moses. Not just him coming to have head knowledge. I believe Moses had head knowledge of God throughout his childhood up until this point. But yet God makes him real, makes himself real in a very personal way. The way God wants us all to be able to come into a real relationship with our God, to know him and to understand him. Now my prayer is, as we look at this biblical account, while it's important we learn about Moses and see what takes place here, but my prayer is that we can see deeper, that we can see Jesus Christ going all the way back into the Old Testament. Because the Old Testament is not just a bunch of random stories strung together to where you get to the New Testament and then you have Jesus and the gospel message. No, the gospel message is something that starts all the way back when God created, starting his plan of redemption, having foreknowledge, knowing that man would sin and that he would bring about a savior of the world. One that would die for all of our sins so that we can come to a place of forgiveness and a real relationship with our God. The gospel message is something that we don't just get past when we are born again. It's not just something that we just stop hearing. It's something that we as Christians need to come back to every single day, knowing what Jesus has done for us, worshiping him. It is the place that we can come to of hearing this message, to put our faith and trust in him, to continue in him all the way to the end. And his grace is sufficient for us, and he wants us to have it. He wants us to have. So I pray that we can even hear the gospel and come to that place of trusting him, even in the Old Testament this morning. Now, there are 3 points this morning that I want us to look at inside of this biblical account. For those of you who are note takers, the first point is the burning bush. The burning bush. I want us to see the significance of it and what God is trying to communicate about himself through this miracle that he performed. Point number 2 that I want us to see is the holy ground. The holy ground. It's very important that we understand that we worship a holy God. God is holy. We cannot neglect that truth in our relationship with him. And point number 3, I want us to see the faithful God. The faithful God. He is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He is committed to his name and his glory to bring about his eternal purpose. He is a faithful God. Now let's go ahead and dive back into verse 1. Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. Now for those of you who are unfamiliar with the story of Moses, I believe there's some context that we need to understand first to fully appreciate what is taking place inside of this biblical account in Exodus 3. Up until this point of God's redemptive history, the people of Israel, who God chose to be able to bring about the Savior of the world through, is in bondage. They're in slavery in Egypt. And this isn't just something that just happened by chance. God prophesied to Abraham, going all the way back into Genesis 15, that his people would go down and spend 400 years in bondage to slavery. And I got to pause and just say that is amazing that they still kept an identity of who they were. We look at the horrendous acts of slavery that occurred within America and how it stripped people of their identity. But yet God's people still kept their identity of being his chosen people, that the Savior of the world would come through even in the midst of the suffering and affliction that they faced. And so 400 years take place, and God promised that he would bring them out of there for him to be able to complete his plan, to complete his perfect work of what he is trying to accomplish through them. And so that's where Moses steps up onto the scene. You see, the name Moses literally means to be drawn out or called out. And that's exactly who Moses was to God. He was God's instrument that was called out of bondage, of slavery and everything, to come to the place to be used of God to lead the people of Israel out of that bondage and take them to the promised land. He was drawn out. And he has a very peculiar life in which he led compared to the rest of his Hebrew brothers and sisters. You see, Moses as a baby, when he was born at a time that the Pharaoh, who feared the Hebrew people, that they would come to power and take away from the wealth of the Egyptian people, that he decided to put a decree out to kill any sons that were born to the Hebrew people. And this is the time that Moses was born. And it tells us about godly women and mothers who hid their children to save their sons in this process, and Moses' mother being one of them. But it came to the point where she struggled. I don't know how to hide this baby boy who should have been put to death. And so we read the account where Moses' mother and sister put Moses in a basket and floats him down a river to where they knew that Pharaoh's daughter was bathing at. And Pharaoh's daughter saw this baby and saw that he was a special baby and took him in. God's favor was there with Moses in this whole situation for God's purpose of how he wanted to use Moses. And so Moses was adopted by the Pharaoh's daughter. And so he lived a very different life. He was on one hand raised with all the privilege and power and education that a world empire could extend to one of their royalty. He was a prince of Egypt. But yet on the other side, God in his sovereignty still saw that he needed to have some form of Hebrew connection. And yet he decided that his mother would be the one who would nanny him and raise him. As Pharaoh's daughter said, send for a midwife from the Hebrew people to be able to come and raise this child. And so Moses was still raised by his mother, one who was God-fearing enough to want to save his baby boy. And so he was raised with this understanding of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that came to the promised Israel people. And so he, being raised in this fashion, after 40 years, it tells us that spending 40 years in Egypt, that he goes out to go look at his brothers and sisters, his Hebrew people, and saw them under the slavery, the bondage that they were in, the cruelty of the taskmasters, and how they would cry to God for help. And Moses decided to take action into his own hands. He really believed at one point, according to Acts chapter 7, that he would be the one to deliver them from that bondage. That where he came to the point of killing a taskmaster, trying in his own strength to be a savior to his people. But yet, that failed. The next day, he went to his Hebrew brothers and sisters, and they were arguing and quarreling. And he said, "Why do you fight?" And they said to him, "What is it to you? Are you going to kill us just like you killed that Egyptian?" And Moses knew. He knew that everybody knew what he had done. And he was afraid. And he saw that they were not looking to him as a savior in any way. And he fled. He fled to Midian, which is hundreds of miles across a wilderness desert. And eventually he came to be a part of the Midian people. Now, it's very important that we understand that the Midian people were people who had knowledge of the true God. They were not of the line of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but yet they were of the line of Abraham. You see, after Abraham's first wife, Sarah, died, he remarried, and his second wife had a son named Midian. And that knowledge of God still passed down to his child, as we see here inside of verse 1, that Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. They had priests. They had knowledge of God. They wanted to worship God. And Moses' lifestyle completely changed over the next 40 years. He married the priest's daughter. He married the pastor's daughter, if you will. And he worked under the authority of his father-in-law to be a shepherd for 40 years. And that's where we come into the context of chapter 3 here, where Moses is approximately 80 years old at this point. 80 years old. And it's very important that we see this. Now, I know I gave 3 points, but there's just, I'm going to inject one other point, if you will. I don't have a name for the point, so just put a question mark next to it. That, you know, we hear the story of Moses, and we see about the going with the 10 plagues and him standing before Pharaoh saying, "Let my people go," and the Red Sea splitting and all the miracles that came. It is an awesome book to read to see what God did. All of it being a picture of the salvation experience that is to take place with God saving the world from the bondage of sin and washing them and making them clean and making his own people for his eternal purpose. But you know, we think about the works of God and how God wants to work in our lives, and we tend to think about doing big things. But I want us to just note right now that we cannot undermine the little things of life. It is very important, whether it's your work, whether it's your day-to-day as a husband or wife or as a parent, everything really matters, and God is using it and how he wants to use you. You see, Ephesians 2:10 says that you are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works that were predestined beforehand. God already knows what he wants to do in and through your life. Yes, it is by faith that we engage in that work, but we cannot undermine the preparation of him working on us. You see, did Moses know over the 40 years that God was going to call him to use him in this way? Not after what happened in Egypt. I don't believe so. I believe he's just living this quiet life, being a husband, being a father, working as a shepherd. And it says that he took his father-in-law's flock out into the wilderness to the Mount Horeb. Now, Mount Horeb is the same as Mount Sinai. This is the location in which the Ten Commandments are given to Moses to give to the Israelite people after they've already crossed through the wilderness. But yet, God was preparing Moses all this time to be a shepherd, to lead a flock of animals that are not highly intelligent through a wilderness all the way to this place. And that's the very thing that he was used for, to be a leader for God's people, to lead, to shepherd them all the way through a wilderness to this very mountain. It's just amazing to me. So please, whatever God wants to do in your life, do not undermine or neglect the little things in life, because they are not little. They are consequential to what God wants to do in and through you. Let's move on to verses 2 and 3. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. And so this brings us to the point of the burning bush. It's very important that we see the significance of this. You see, first it tells us that the angel of the Lord appears to him in a flame of fire in the midst of this fiery bush. Now, many theologians argue over who the angel of the Lord is, whether it's an angel that's just being a messenger for the Lord to communicate God's word. And we see specifically, you go further on, it says God said. It doesn't say the angel said, it says God said. Or some interpret this as Christ himself, what is called a Christophany occurring, coming to him in the fiery bush. Regardless of where you stand on this, we need to understand that this is God himself speaking to Moses, appearing to Moses in the midst of this fiery bush that is being burned but yet not consumed. You see, Moses, being a shepherd for 40 years inside of this region, he's very familiar with the vegetation that is out there, whether or not a bush should be set on fire and whether or not it would be consumed. This was a sight to see, a bush, a dry bush in a dry climate set on fire, but not consumed. This is nothing short than a miracle of God. Only God can take something flammable, light it on fire, and preserve it to the point that it is not consumed. Now, we could easily just read past this, going into what God says to Moses. But I want us to understand that while this was a sight to see, and it did get Moses' attention, as it said that Moses saw it, and he turned aside, literally, to go and inspect this fiery bush. What is this thing I am seeing? God does not just do miracles for the sake of doing miracles or to just get attention. When we read about miracles in the Bible, they are always pointing to God to communicate some truth about who he is. Inside of the Gospel of John, chapter 20, it says that these things were written, specifically miracles, were written that we may believe in Jesus Christ. All the miracles in the New Testament point to Christ, whether it's the bread of life or the living water or the water to wine with the new birth. All of these miracles are very important. And so we should not just move past when we see God perform a miracle in the Bible. And so we have this fiery bush. We must understand that this miracle is pointing to Christ himself. Thousands of years later, from the point in which Moses has this interaction with God and witnesses this fiery bush, Jesus Christ came on this earth to die for our sins. He himself is the burning bush that was not consumed by fire. Whether or not you interpret it as him on a tree, on a cross, facing the fiery judgments of sin in this life, being tempted in all ways, yet still without sin. He who knew no sin became sin for us, drinking the wrath of God. Christ has tasted it in every form of way, and he was not consumed. His flesh died, but he was raised from the dead, and is victorious and lives forever. And he's extended that gift for us all. If we repent of our sins and believe in him, trust in him, that we can have everlasting life too. Jesus wore a crown of thorns on his head. This bush, the Hebrew word for it, communicates things along the lines of a thorny bush that was in the wilderness. And it was not consumed. Christ wore that crown for us. He took it all for us. He took the fiery judgment that we deserve. He was a man on fire, but yet not consumed by it. And the amazing thing is that this gift of his grace and the way that he extends it to us extends it to us in a way that we too are to be people of God who are on fire for Him. The fiery pains and flames of this life, we are to have an unquenchable hope that is inside of our heart, peace and joy and fruit of the Spirit, that even if we die, even if we perish, we know where we are going. We know the eternity that we have with Him, that we should not faint, that we should not lose it, that we would not be consumed, even if we physically perish. It's just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego being faced with judgment, saying, bow to worship this false god or be thrown in the fire. They said, we believe our God will deliver us, but if not, we will not bow. They were thrown in a fiery furnace so hot that they should have melted, but yet God preserved them. Christ was with them. He showed up, the fourth man in the fire, right beside them. And that is Christ with us and our relationship with Him. That He is the unquenchable one and He lives inside of you. He is the one who cannot be consumed and He is the one who will preserve you by faith in Him and the work that He has done. So please do not skip over the fiery bush without seeing Christ in it and what He has done for you on the cross and the Christian He calls you to be, even in the midst of fiery trials, to be able to still have faith and hope. And He provides the grace that is needed regardless of what happens in the flesh. Let us move on. Verse 4 and 5. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. Then he said, do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And it says that once God saw that he turned aside. You see, the fiery bush did get his attention. It pulled him aside to see, and that's when God spoke to him. And our Lord tells us that if he be lifted up, he will draw all men unto himself. And he waits for us to turn and to see. And then he speaks to us through his word, through the Holy Spirit. And he spoke to Moses here. He said, Moses, Moses. And Moses' response was, here I am. It is very similar to the same situation that happened with Samuel when he was a little boy. That God came to him in 1 Samuel and saying, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. Now, I just want us to notice that he is calling him by name. Yes, God is omniscient, but we should not take it for granted that the God of the universe, the creator, the most awesome being there is, the one who is worthy of all praise and worship, calls by name. He knows your name. He's calling you by name. He's saying, Matilda, Matilda. He knows every hair on our heads. He wants that personal relationship. And he loves us enough to repeat himself. To repeat himself. Yes, we see in all through the Bible, anytime repetition is taking place, it means something important is about to be communicated. But we need to look at this through the lens of God as a father, as a parent, because he is so patient with us enough that he will repeat himself for you. I am learning to be patient as a parent. I am learning. Oftentimes I have to be like, Matilda, Matilda. Say her name twice, repeat myself. It may be frustrating. We don't see God getting flustered here. We need to learn from his example of patience. Yeah, he calls Moses by name. Moses says, here I am. I've heard of you before, God. I am here. What does God say to him? Verse 5. Then he said, do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. Point number two, holy ground. Holy ground. This is something so important enough for God to repeat himself. We better pay close attention. God is holy. God is holy. That is a truth we must keep. Yes, it carries ideas and meaning behind it of being clean or pure, light, as we talked about in Sunday school. Thank you, Nate. But yet, it really carries the meaning also to be set apart or not common. We need to understand that God is holy. There is no one like God. He is not a common thing. He is not a common person. He is God, and there is only one God, and you are not God. I am not God. Creatures have tried, Lucifer has tried, saying, I will be like the Most High. We see the consequence of sin for that, because there can only be one God. There can be no other God. And we cannot treat God as something as common. You know, I'm afraid that that's where I see Christianity today. As we go through our lives, he's just something we tack on. Like, I have this Christian part of my life, but yet I'm just moving, going forward in my life. No, God is to be completely set apart. Your life is to be holy as well, as it tells us in 1 Peter that just as he is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. You be set apart, your life set apart for God, for him to use you in whatever way he chooses. Now, the holiness in our life does not mean perfection, performance perfection. You can just look at me and see an example of that. It's not perfect, but it means to be set apart, our whole heart devoted and committed to him, where he is the Lord of our life. He is to be holy. He is holy. And he tells Moses, do not draw near this place. Take off your sandals, for this is holy ground. This is the same very place, as I mentioned earlier, the Ten Commandments were given. In that circumstance, when that was occurring, God gave Moses instructions to put up a barrier, saying, tell them, do not cross over this line where I am at over here and going to give you the Ten Commandments. If you cross over, you will die. We cannot approach God in our own strength. There is no way. He says, do not come near this place. You will die trying to come to God on your own. You will fall short. You cannot do it in your own strength. He has made a way through Christ that we can be made holy, that we can be forgiven. And he says, take off your sandals, Moses. You see, your shoes, they're dirty. They're dirty. Wherever you go, you track all the dirt. But it's to be a symbolism of where you've been in your life. The sin that you have committed, you need to take that off. And the only way you can take it off is to be cleansed by the blood of Christ, to be forgiven by him because of who he is and what he's done through repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. It is holy ground, and he's a holy God. You cannot come to him on your own, but he's made a way. He's made a way. Verse 6, and he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Point number 3, the faithful God. The faithful God. He tells him, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And this communicates the reality that God has his own plan and his own purpose of what he is trying to accomplish. And he had promised Abraham that he would bring it about regardless. He was going to bring it about. And he is at work, and he has done it. He's brought his son, Jesus Christ, through these people. And we can read all the stories through the Old Testament of how God stayed faithful even whenever the Israelite people became faithless. Faithless. God was still performing his work. It tells us inside of 1 Timothy chapter 2, It says that even if we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny his name. He cannot deny himself of what he has established, why he created. He created you for a love relationship with him for all eternity, in which you can be able to behold his glory and know him and understand him. And it can only come through Christ. And he was fully committed to that way. Now we are still responsible to repent of our sin and have faith, persevering until the end. We are to abide. We are to continue. But this, if we are faithless, he still remains faithful, speaks to the reality that God will still fulfill his plan with or without you. He will. His eternity will come to be. He will still have his bride, and it will be glorious. And I look forward to the day that we can be praising him and worshiping him before his throne in heaven. It will be beautiful. He is faithful. But notice, though, that what Moses' response, it says, and Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. You see, in light of a holy God, and you not being holy, you being born a sinner, you who have committed sins in your life that deserve death, that deserve hell, if you stand before this God, you would hide, you would fall as dead men, as we see in the Bible in so many instances. Moses hid his face. He was ashamed of his sin. He was a murderer. He murdered that Egyptian taskmaster trying to operate in his own strength. But yet God called him. And God's grace is sufficient to forgive Moses, as it is sufficient to forgive you of your sin. But I don't want to just stop there, leaving you with Moses being afraid to look at God, because that is not where God wants to leave you. He does not want to leave you at a place where you are afraid to look at him. He wants you to look at him. If you've repented of your sin and are trusting him and believing with him, the Bible tells us in the New Testament that we are to come boldly before the throne of grace. We are to come boldly to him as children, knowing that we have a relationship with our heavenly Father. And I love the book of Exodus because it doesn't just leave Moses like this. While in this first appearing of God to him, he hid his face. We end the book of Exodus in Exodus chapter 3, where it tells us that Moses now communed with God as one face to face, as one does with a friend. Is that who God is to you? I pray that we can come to that place, all of us, that when the enemy throws fiery darts at us over our past sins that have already been forgiven, that we can take thoughts captive, put that aside, and come to the reality of the truth of where God has us, that we are not to be stuck in our shame, but that we are to come talk with him as one face to face, like a friend who cares. He is a loving Father, and he loves us. I know that we've all been through trials this week, and I thank God for them. I thank God. I don't want to go through it again. I want running water in my house. I'm going to think twice about flushing the toilet now, looking at how much water it takes to fill up a toilet and flush it manually. But God has been faithful. God has been good. And he's also made himself known that he is a holy God, and he will judge sin, as we saw this week on his judgment against this world. But you, his children, his people, he wants you to have peace. He wants you to have joy. He wants you to be led by the Spirit and commune with him as a friend. Let's go ahead and sing our invitational hymn. Just as I am. You can come to him just as you are. Receive forgiveness. Number 342. just as I am, just as you are. You know, if I look back 13 years ago and saw the person I was before Christ saved me, I wouldn't believe that I would be here today. And I know many people in this room can give many testimonies to the same thing of how Christ has worked in their life. And I had a friend last night send me a text message saying he wants to be saved, but he struggles with anger. And I pray, and pray that I can have a conversation with him this afternoon, that we can come to him as we are. You cannot fix your sin in your own strength. It is only by his grace, and he will help you. He will be faithful. He is committed to helping you step by step, whatever it is. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for how good you are. For your grace, Lord, that you've given us through your Son, Jesus Christ, that we can be forgiven, that we can come as sinners, God, to a holy God because of the work you have done. Lord, thank you. We worship you and praise you for that. Allow this truth to continue on in the people of this church, Lord, that they will be friends with you face to face, communing, listening to you, being who you want them to be on this side of eternity for your glory. Be with us as we leave here. Protect us and help those in need. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You are dismissed.